I want to reintroduce you to a man whom you're already very familiar with because he's been in the game and the fight for many years, standing up for what we like to call the humans on this side, and it's none other than Mike Papantonio. And he's filed a class action suit in three states against British Petroleum, has been and is back and forth to New Orleans looking at this BP spill. It's such the wrong word, isn't it, Mike?
Yeah, it's gusher, I think, is more appropriate. It is a gusher. BP likes to use the word tiny spill.
As though it were a glass of milk or food.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, gee whiz. We spilled something. Yeah. But no, it's almost out of control. Right now they've covered 65 miles of shoreline in Louisiana. And the importance of that shoreline, it's basically the most important marshland in the United States, both from an aquifer standpoint and from a standpoint of that's where birds nest. That's where you have every kind of sea life that spawns there in that area. So they've basically already wiped out the ecosystem pretty much. You know, to talk about, to put it in human terms, you know, we get the telephone calls from people that have been three generations in the shrimping business or two generations in the oyster business. Well, they're out of business. I mean, it's over. And I guess the story that's not told here enough, and we just have to talk about it, is how does this occur? You know, it doesn't just occur because of one idiot. It takes many idiots. And now we're finding that the idiots really go all the way up to Ken Salazar level of idiot. You know,
right, and let me just jump in and say these idiots have been at it for decades. This isn't their first boo-boo. I mean, these go back to the 1980s, Alaska, all over this country. There's been a nonstop, egregious amount of these oily erectations. This is not a first time.
Well, yeah, but it only happens where government allows it to happen. And I think the story that's evolving right now, I heard Ken Salazar the other day say, you know, if we find out that BP isn't doing what they're supposed to, then we're going to step in. I mean, what a ridiculous statement. It's almost like he doesn't need – it's almost like he forgets. They've already lied to us about the fact that they never tested the blowout preventer that would have prevented this. They've already lied to us about that they had no catastrophe plan at all. They've lied to us that this system had been failing for losing hydraulics for 2 weeks before they took any action and chose to take no action at all, and that was part of the problem. So
let's remind people who Ken Salazar is. He's the Interior Secretary under the Obama administration, a guy who's really in charge of having this done. And the harsh words that he's saying are not met by action. And that's where you step in, right, Mike?
Right. I mean, you know, this case is more about it. Look, it's about bigger things than the lawsuit. The lawsuit's a big, big issue. Don't get me wrong. But it's about how our government is working. Why do you have a guy like Ken Salazar there to begin with? Look, environmentalists were outraged when Obama put Salazar in charge of the Interior. We saw there was no opposition at all from the Republicans, and for good reason. They loved a guy like Salazar. He'd always been their lapdog. He led the change to end, if you recall, he led the change to end offshore drilling moratoriums. I mean, he said, yeah, go ahead and drill. He was the front man who supported huge multi-million dollar tax breaks for Exxon during a time that Exxon was reporting $42 billion profits annually. He led the charge against increased CAFE standards that would have mandated better mileage and better laws that would have protected us from greenhouse gases. He voted against that. He voted against a bill that for the first time would have required that the Army Corps of Engineers consider climate change when they come up with a project. So this is a guy that it's almost like having Colonel Sanders guarding our chickens. And it's not much different than what we saw when Obama put, we put Geithner and Summers in charge of the financial world. It's the same kind of thing. Now, I don't say that because, you know, I'm a huge fan of Obama. I've always supported Obama. But there has to be a reality check for him right now. And he has to take a look at who is around him. Because it's almost like that frog that's in the boiling water. Well, you know, he boils a little bit. He doesn't really feel anything. Boils a little bit more. Before he knows it, he's boiling to death. And what he has is a bunch of advisors that really come right out of the Bill Clinton, centrist days. It's almost like Bush Light. And so now's the time for him to look at a guy like Salazar and say, who are these people that have surrounded me right now? And
it seems like he cut a deal to, continue the Pentagon in its full glory right out of the Bush years and continue business as usual. Unfortunately, the citizenry is suffering. Harrison, with you, we're talking to Mike Papantonio. You know him from Ring of Fire Radio. That's ringoffireradio.com. He appears regularly on virtually every network. He has filed class action suits against BP and is really leading the charge to expose much of the political monkey shines and the lack of energy and effort. A lot of wordplay, but no action backing it up. And this oil rupture, this volcanic effluvium, this explosion from the Earth's belly button, is not just going to go away because we wish it to, or as yesterday we had a bioacoustician on talking about the sheer pressure of 2,000 pounds per square inch and dropping 5,000-foot chopsticks down there to try to move stuff around. And it's either going to dry out in a month from now or 2 months from now. And we have a government that's sitting around going, well, you know, this is very inconvenient, and we're on the side of the fishermen. What can we do as regular citizens?
Well, the first thing we can do is admit the obvious, and that is that they do have there is a way to do this, and nobody is causing. It's almost like it's happening silently around us, and this white elephant sitting in the living room, and we're what the hell is that? A piece of furniture? Well, here it is. It's 700 million gallons of oil were spilled in Saudi Arabia in 1995. They were spilled into bays and gulfs there. And what they did is Shell brought in super tankers. Each super tanker holds 80 million gallons, and they sucked the oil right out of the Gulf, and they treated it. And you know what? They cleaned up 85% of the problem. You know why that's not happening here?
And isn't that oil sitting in the tankers to be resold right now?
Well, if you think about it, the tankers are all sitting out there right now, and they're just waiting for prices to increase. But here's the point. They could use those tankers to clean up the Gulf right now. They have 24 tankers. Each tanker holds 80 million gallons. They can suck the oil right into the tanker, take it to shore, store it until they can treat it, come back and get more. The reason they're not doing that, Harrison, is because they're too busy making money with the tankers they have. The tankers are sitting offshore waiting for prices to increase in a place like Asia, so then they take the tanker to Asia, or prices to increase in Europe, they take another tanker to Europe. These tankers should be mandated to go to the Gulf and do in America what was done in Saudi Arabia when Shell Oil fixed the problem. Now, this is not a new theory. Hell, I mean, the past president of Shell, Hoffmeister, says this absolutely will work. And he doesn't understand why it's not being used right now. And he does understand, but he can't admit it. You know, he comes from the oil industry. It's not being used because they don't want to tie up the super tankers with the problem they have here when they can still be making money around the world.